We got our new servo motor, and I haven't even opened it yet. It just arrived today. It's still in the box, still sealed up, and I want to get it out of here. My goal here is, by the end of this video, to have that CNC machine running. I have no idea what it's going to take to do that, but the first step is to get this box open, and let's see what happens. Hey, it's Pete. Welcome back to the workshop. So the goal this week is to get this new 1,000-watt DMM servo motor mounted on our spindle, get it tuned, and get that finalized. I need to get the machine turned around. We still have to replace one of the Deutsch connectors on the front, the Y-axis stepper motor. I can't reach that from where it's at right now, so that never got done. But that's a quick job. Once that's done, the machine should be ready to run. And if everything goes as planned, this video will end with that machine making chips. Before going forward with the install of the 1,000-watt motor, I thought it might be a good idea to go backwards just a little bit and discuss what happened to the 750-watt motor. When I started trying to tune the motor, I wasn't having much luck, and I exchanged several emails back and forth with DMM Tech. They gave me a lot of good input, but none of it was really working. So then our conversation transitioned to talking about the motor itself and what exactly its physical capabilities were, and things like inertia. The 750-watt motor has an inertia rating of 2.45 kilogram centimeter square. And that number is not really important for the sake of this discussion of understanding that, but what is important is remembering the 2.45. Now, DMM Tech says that that motor has an inertia ratio of up to 20 times. That you can think of that as a mismatch between the inertia of the motor itself and the machine you're trying to drive. And although it's 20 times, they would prefer that it actually would be 10 times. So at that point, we're at 24.5 kilograms centimeter squared. So the question becomes, what is actually the inertia of the machine? And we tried to do some estimating and calculating of things, but in the end, I just decided that the best way to find out was to pull the spindle and actually measure it. I didn't want to take the head off the machine again to press the spindle out, and I started wondering in a similar situation what Uchel at Woods Creek Workshop might do. I decided he would probably call Randy Richards, and since I don't know Randy Richards' phone number, I just decided to whack it with a mallet. I actually discovered, although just a little bit too late, that there is a way of pushing that spindle out of there with hydraulic pressure without actually using a mechanical press. It's actually built into the spindle, and if we ever have to pull the spindle out of there again, we'll try doing it that way. Now, DMM Tech shared a formula with me, which was half the mass of the spindle times the radius squared. Putting the spindle on the scale along with a sample piece of tooling, I came up with 3.33 kilograms. Coming up with the average spindle diameter was a bit more involved. I came up with an average spindle diameter of 5.41 centimeters. And again, this is still just an estimate. It does not take into account the moving portion of the spindle bearings themselves, which would be attached to that spindle. But it gets us in the ballpark. So with a radius of 2.705 centimeters and a mass of 3.33 kilograms, I ended up with an inertia calculation of 12.183 kilograms centimeter squared. And if you remember back, our target number we wanted to be less than was 24.5 kilograms centimeter squared. But that does not take into account the pulley ratio that we're going for. We have a 2-to-1 pulley ratio. With the motor maxed out at 5,000 RPM, the spindle's supposed to go 10K. But when calculating inertia, it's a square. So the 10K pulley setting, we end up with an inertia calculation of 48.732. And with the 750-watt motor, that is a 19.8 times multiplier there. And that's still within the 20 times, but that does not take into account any friction in the machine. It doesn't take into account actually having a cutter and actually doing work. It's just strictly the spindle itself. So we're right there at the upper limit of their claimed range with nowhere to go. And that's how we ended up with the 1,000-watt spindle motor. The 1,000-watt motor has an inertia rating of 3.71 kilograms centimeter squared. We end up with an inertia mismatch there of 13.17. That's just above the 10 times that we'd really like to have and gives us a lot of leeway there for actually doing work. Again, not wanting to take the head off the machine to press the spindle back in, I use the jam nut that holds the step pulley with a piece of aluminum tubing to wind the spindle up in place. The next issue I ran into was excessive runout on the step pulley for the spindle motor. In a previous video, I had a rather sketchy setup I tried using to enlarge the bore size of the pulley bushing to accommodate the 14 millimeter shaft on these motors. When I originally installed the 750 watt motor, I had great luck with it. It just went together, but that luck seems to have run out. I cannot get this pulley bushing to go on the new motor with any sort of runout that's acceptable. I decided the only way to move forward was to create a new pulley bushing from scratch. I started with a scrap piece of 1 5/16 cold rolled steel and just took measurements from the original bushing. There's going to be very little commentary in this section. I will leave a timestamp down in the video description if you want to skip past the machining of this part and get to the actual motor installation. If you like this kind of content, please consider clicking that subscribe button. It really helps the channel out. The diameter here isn't critical, it just needed to have enough meat left for the set screws, and it had to finish at a size that I had a collet for. I will have links down in the video description to some of the tools I used this time around. I could have tapped this hole before removing the part from the lathe, but I had to order the tap and didn't have it on hand when I got to this point. I also had to order in a larger slitting blade, but I was able to use the smaller one I had on hand to get the job set up and started. With all that done, I could get back to mounting the motor. I used a bolt down on the end of the motor shaft to help seat the bushing before tightening the set screws. The pulley slipped onto the bushing with a rather satisfying feel. I wanted to verify the RPM, so I used an optical tachometer. This is an old Pocket Tech 100 made by Monarch. With 5,000 RPM at the motor, the spindle was measuring within 5 RPM of the nameplate rating.
I'm going to do S1000, M3, start. S2000, M3. M5.
Well, it's taken way longer to get to this point than I ever anticipated. There's no way at the beginning of this video I ever would have predicted that I was going to have to make one of these pulley bushings. So that ate up a whole lot of time I wasn't anticipating. Also, with the Y-axis stepper motor, the connector on there we need to replace, another thing that slipped my mind is that the home switches for all three axes have never been mounted on the machine, so they all need to be mounted and wired in. And finally, I discovered that I don't have any hardware at all that'll fit the T-slots in this table. I've got no way of clamping down a workpiece to even try to do a test cut. We got a bit of an anniversary coming up. Next week is actually the 1 year anniversary of the first video that I uploaded in this series of retrofitting the DM2800 milling machine, retrofitting it to the Acorn control system. And I'd like to say that, the goal here is we're going to get this thing done next week for the anniversary, at least phase one of the project. Obviously, there's the Ether 1616 board sitting in there with all that I/O that we haven't even touched. So there's plenty of room for expansion and projects down the way. But at least as far as having a working machine, that's kind of my goal that I'm shooting for now. If you want to see how the project started a year ago, Click that link to the left and I'll catch you over there.